The following video is sponsored by the Greek American Heritage Society of Philadelphia.
Well, he's anxious to get right back into it. And he is.
Oh, they're really throwing the leather around. 30 seconds to go in the round, and Pantellas looks hurt.
There's not much force in those blows of Vega right now. Right above us, what you see landing is not as hard as it may look. That was it. That was it. What a right. No doubt about it. A right hand uppercut, caught a flush. The mouthpiece is out. It's got to be over now. It's over.
Right hand by Augie Pantellis. He's praying in the ring now. Or he looked up. He goes over to Isaac Vega.
And then from 72 to 77, I got even worse. But then Jesus came into my life and he saved me.
Lightweight boxer throughout the 60s and 70s, he temporarily ended his career and then returned back in 77 through 79, where he gained much fame and attention. He also grew up in the St. Demetrius Greek Orthodox community in West Philadelphia at the original church. His name, August Socrates Pantellis, but today his name has gone and become synonymous with the history of boxing throughout the Delaware Valley. We know him as the Brumo Bomber, Augie Pantellis. Augie, welcome to Cosmos Philly. Let me reach over and shake your hand and tell you what a pleasure it is to finally sit here with you. You've got quite a history. Could you elaborate a little bit on growing up in West Philadelphia, where you were born and your family?
Okay, my family, my grandparents were from Greece. My parents, Harriet Heraclia and Constantine, my parents' name, they were born here. Everybody spoke fluent Greek, read, write everything. So I'm a full-blooded Greek. I grew up in West Philly. I started out at the St. Demetrius Church at 50th and Larchwood. I just played in the streets of West Philly. We belonged to the Boy Scouts at the St. Demetrius.
So tell me a little bit more. You guys moved into the Highland Park area, then into Brumo. How did you, what was life like for you growing up? Kind of a Greek American. Did you guys speak much Greek at home?
Well, not too much at home. Family gatherings, all Greek. And American, you know, but in the home it was mostly American. My grandmother, when she lived with us, spoke Greek with my mom and dad, you know. No, it was mostly American in my home, but parties, Greek dances, stuff like that. Yeah, they all...
Did your parents follow any Greek traditions that you remember growing up?
Well, my grandmother made the bread with the egg, Easter and every Easter we'd say Christos Anesti, Alathos Anesti. Yeah, but as I was growing up, I just was a crazy little kid. I really didn't, understand much Greek, but everybody spoke Greek.
Let's move forward out of your childhood. You went to Upper Darby High School locally, and there you were a wrestler. You found yourself in a position of great strength and ability, and Can you tell us how that opened the door to your boxing career?
Well, I used to, I wasn't a mean person, but I just, I guess I liked to fight because my wrestling ability and my strength from wrestling and all, it was just, you know, I just had it in me like, you know, like, are you talking to me? Are you talking to me? I couldn't wait for something like that to happen. I would take him down. I'd get him in a hold. I'd make him submit. I was doing that way before this MMA stuff happened in the street. And I used to fight all the time. But like I said, I wasn't mean. I just liked to show people I was tougher than the other person. And one day my friend Jerry DiCaprio came and said, "Aug, you're doing all this fighting in the streets. Guys from South Philly, West Philly, North Philly, they were all looking for me. They heard about fighting all these guys and beating all these guys. They would actually come looking for me. Who's this guy who's beating up my friend or this friend?" A Villanova football player came here one time. I took him down, got him in a hold, and he couldn't believe it. And I made him submit. And my friend Jerry said, "Why don't you become a prize fighter? You make money. You're doing it in the street here. You know, you become a prize fighter. You make some money." And you know, of all the sports, I played football, I wrestled, I ran track, baseball, all the sports. Boxing was the only sport I never really, you know, the only boxing I ever saw was on television when my dad used to watch it. I never was interested in boxing. But I said, "Oh, I don't know, you know, this and that." And then I ended up quitting high school, job hopping, this and that and everything. And one day, my friend who was boxing down in Philly, I went down with him and I watched it and I said, "Hey, man, this is, you know." So I went back to Jerry. I said, "Hey, Jerry, you know, I'm thinking of fighting. Yeah, my friend was there. I really liked it. I'd like to try it." So he said, "Don't do anything. Don't do anything." He went and got talked to Sam Margolis, my manager. Sam Margolis sent us to Marty Feldman, and Marty showed me everything I know today from boxing. And I didn't know anything about boxing. I didn't even like the sport, but because of the wrestling, being strong from wrestling, being a natural athlete, I picked it up. I had no fear, which helps. And I learned. And
when did you actually launch your career as a boxer?
1967. So all this started a year before that. Practicing, training, learning.
Where were you training? Where were you
at? Passyunk and Moore. That's where I started. Passyunk and Moore.
Do you remember your first bout?
Yeah.
As a professional?
Yeah.
Where? What was that like?
Smith in Boston. Yeah, I'll never forget that because he came in at 135 pounds. I was 126. And they were complaining about that and all. But, you know, the fight had to go on. Yeah, I stopped him. I stopped him, like, in the second round. But it was just, you know, my first fight. He probably wasn't. Although he was, like, for his size, he was, like, you know, scary looking. But, you know, I stopped him. Then I lost my second fight. I lost my third fight. I was ready to quit because I thought, you know, it wasn't easy. You know, wrestling came to me. I loved it. But boxing, you're taking shots. It's a little different. And after I lost my second fight, my third fight, from inexperience, you know, I never had any amateur fights. I trained. I started as a pro. So after that, I was ready to quit. Marty said, "Look, you're doing real good in the gym. You're learning. Just hang in there." And like after that, I start winning. You know, I had like a string of knockouts. And everybody I fought had more experience than me because they all went through the amateur, boxing thing. You know, I never fought amateur.
So let's go forward from 67 to 72. You had built a reputation. You were an experienced boxer, but now you've left boxing. What happened during that time frame?
Well, just prior to me leaving, I got involved with my demons, with the drugs, the Beatles, all that. And it all started smoking pot and then pills and then harder stuff. It just got worse and worse and worse. And by the time 72 came, I had to just stop. I was half a man. I was still fighting. I was, you know. So, and then from 72 to 77, I got even worse. But then Jesus came into my life, and he saved me. He took the drugs away. He made me strong again, and I came back and I fought again for two more years, 77 to 79, and all my fights were praising the name of Jesus those 2 years.
Can we talk about how that moment came to be, how you felt?
Because of my initial time when I was a child, going to church and learning of Christ and this and really believing with all my heart and soul that Jesus was God as a youth. As I grew up and stopped going to church and all that stuff and getting into the world, he called me back. He called me back and said, look, you're going to die if you continue this way. And then I came back, and I called my trainer up, Marty. I said, Marty, I quit drugs. I'm off. Jesus is in my life. And they wanted me to, you know, they were talking about making a comeback anyway. But I said, I can't, you know. But then when Jesus changed my whole life. He just made me a new creation, gave me my strength back and all. But because of my age, I was 33 to 35. I didn't have what I had when I was younger, even though I was had my demons then. And, you know, I still had that extra strength that I had. It kept me going, even though I was messed up.
So 77 to 79, you returned to the boxing world. A brief career. What was the difference between that second career and your first career? What were the primary differences? How did you box differently?
I still did good. I was still knocking men out. I still had what I had when I was younger. You lose maybe a little speed, maybe a little strength, but you're a little smarter too. So, you know, you're a little smarter. But when I fought Bobby Chacon, I was 35. He was 26. He was already a champion who lost the title. He came back. He stopped me in the seventh round. He went and fought Boza Edwards. Stopped him in the last round. Won the title.
So that was pretty much the end of your career in 79.
Yeah, I stopped in 79. And
what would you say boxing taught you? That span from 67 to 79, what did boxing give you?
Well, I'll tell you, I was praising the Lord so much, I can't even say boxing gave me anything. Christ gave me everything. Everything.
Was there a lesson from boxing?
Yeah. Anybody who wants to be a fighter, don't fight. It's a very, very tough sport, very demanding. You're taking shots all the time. It's a very, very tough sport. I believe I could have gone all the way if I was a good boy, if I didn't mess around, but it's very, of all the sports in the world, nothing is like prize fighting because you're taking pinpoint shots every day in the gym, boom, from bigger guys too. So, you know, you get these marathon runners, you know what kind of shape they have to be in for 26 miles? You hit them on the jaw once, they're out for a week. You know what I mean? Nothing is like the conditioning of a prize fighter. No sport has the condition of a top-notch prize fighter.
The career's over, 79's gone. You found your faith again. What have you been doing since 79? It's been quite a while. We've heard some news that you've done some celebrity boxing.
Oh, right.
Since. What else have you been doing with you've become a family man again?
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about this. You're a family man, celebrity boxing.
Right, and I have a hot dog stand in Media, right in front of the courthouse, front in Veterans Square. And I've been there since 30 years. In fact, right after I stopped fighting, my dad had a stand on the University of Pennsylvania. Okay. He was selling pretzels and water ice. So when I stopped fighting, I didn't know what to do. You know, I dropped out of high school. I'm an ex-prize fighter, a drug abuser. Now, what am I going to do now? So the Lord led me to media. I started off with a little wooden hot dog cart with pretzels and water ice. Then I added hot dogs and this and that. Now I have a big stand with more stuff, you know, meatballs and sausage and, you know.
Born a Greek American, are there any parts of it that you still continue with in your daily life? Is there any part of your past or part of your ethnic past that you celebrate as a Greek American today?
Well, as far as Christos Anesti, you know, that's every year we say Christos Anesti, Alathos Anesti. But like I said, and I know a lot of Greeks, but I just don't speak Greek. You know, I know a few words here, a few words there, and I'm so sorry. I run into some older Greeks, and you don't speak Greek? Nah. They go, nah, you don't speak Greek. You know, I'm sorry for that. Everybody spoke Greek in the family but me.
Is that a regret? Would you say that that's one of your regrets?
Yeah,
that you passed it up?
I just didn't think it was important. Yeah. Today, it's important. I should have known Greek. I should have known how to speak it fluently, read, write. My dad knew how to read, write, everything.
Augie, you've had a wonderful career as a boxer, part of the Greek-American community, family man, six kids. I'm wondering, how do you want to be remembered?
I want to be remembered as a man of faith. More than anything else, a man of faith in Christ Jesus, and that's it. That's how I'm going to be remembered. A man who loved Jesus with all his heart, soul, might, and mind. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Yalo, yalo. Da 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 da. What's that song? Da 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 da. Da da da.
Augie Pantellas scoring a knockout at 2:54.
The time of this bout, 2 minutes 54 seconds of the fifth round, and the winner by knockout, Augie Pantellas!